Hello everyone, in this video we'll have a look to the Mora Gambit. Believe me, it's not a funny thing. If you are not very careful with black, you can be in very big trouble. The Mora Gambit appears after the moves e4, c5, d4, c takes d4, c3, d takes c3, knight c3. I faced this gambit only once in a practical game, and I got losing position after 15 moves. So, and I had some ideas how to play against it. So believe me, we should take it very, very seriously. Why should we take it seriously too? 1 year ago, Vishwanathan Anand played against Esserman, an experienced player in this gambit, and he decided to avoid the Mora gambit. He simply played knight f6, e5, and knight e5. And in this way, we will be in a transposition, and we will be playing the same repertoire that the one which we are planning to play against the Alapin. So, if you are lazy and you don't want to keep on studying and watching this video, you can stop here, you play knight d5, and you don't worry about taking or not taking the pawn. But okay, I decided there should be something for black. We should be able to take this pawn and have an advantage for black. And this moment happened, and this year I found one game in my database. The Iranian Grandmaster Gan Magami was with black, and he found a perfect system. I think black is almost better. I was checking the Mora Gambit for many years and I couldn't find, but finally this idea appeared. So after c3, d takes c3, knight c3, knight c6, knight f3, we are in our main position in this variation, and now it's very important to play e6. Why is so important to play the pawn on e6? Many people are not careful and they play just the move that comes. For example, they decide, okay, now I will play d6, and white plays bishop c4, and now they think, okay, I cannot play bishop d4 because white is playing bishop f7. Okay, I don't want to play e6 because then my bishop will be stuck on c8. Okay, I will play knight f6, and then I will develop my bishop to g4 and I will be fine. But after this move, suddenly white plays e5, and it's not so easy for black to play. And if you make the big mistake to take with a knight on e5, after knight e5, d takes e5, bishop f7, you will lose your queen. So believe me, you should be really careful. Because of that, we will have a look to e6. With the pawn on e6, these active ideas will not appear anymore. And the key of this system is that the knight from g8 normally will go to e7, making e5 completely harmless in every situation. So, after e6, white has several options, and the one with bishop c4, I think it's not very accurate because of my pawn on e6, but most of your opponents will play on this way, so we will have a look to it, of course. First, let's check bishop f4. It's a normal move. This bishop wants to go to d6 at some point, maybe knight b5, who knows. And now it's very important to play with black bishop b4, pinning the knight, and our knight will go to e7 or f6, but first we develop our bishop. How can white play? For example, after bishop d6, we'll simply take on d6, queen d6, and knight f6. Simple development. We could be scared that white can play knight b5, but this is not dangerous because after queen a5, black has no problems at all. So white can play bishop b5, but after queen e7, black is slightly better because it's simply pawn up. White has some compensation, but not much. If white decides to play bishop d3 and not bishop d6, now black plays d6, very important move, because I want this bishop on f4 not to be active, and for that I need to place my pawns on d6 and on e5. Here white can play castle. After rook c1, we'll play e5, and after bishop g5 we can play simply bishop c3, rook c3, and now I very like this move f6 with the idea to play bishop e6, knight g7, castle and d5 at some point. The position is very solid and completely fine. If white plays castle, black will simply take on c3, b takes c3 and e5. And same as before, black is completely fine. No weaknesses and pawn up. So bishop f4 is not worrying. It's not worrying us. So let's have a look to bishop c4. Normal way of developing the pieces. And now it's very important for black to play a6. We should do something with the bishop on c8. And I think this is the best way. Maybe bishop b4 is possible, but I like very much how Gaia Magami played on this game, and I don't feel like I should show something new. So after a6, white castles, and now we play b5, and after bishop b3, bishop b7. Very easy play. I don't wanna play d6. I want the bishop on b3 to be quite passive, and if my pawn e6 is protected by my pawns, it will be much easier. White normally plays queen e2, and now very important move, knight g7. As I told you, I don't want my knight on f6, because I don't wanna be worried about e5 move and then knight e4 at some point. So knight g7, and now bishop g5 was the game. If white plays, for example, a3, now have a look to this setup. It's very important. Knight g6, bishop e3, bishop e7. Normally with black, we would like to get this exact setup. Look, the knight on g6 take control on the e5 square, the knight on c6 too, the bishop on b7 is on the long diagonal, and the bishop on e7 maybe is not so active, but it's taking under control very important squares like g5. If you remember this position, you have half of the job done. So white here plays g3, and now castle h4. We can simply play h6, not to be worried about h5, h6, h6, h5 and knight g5, and black is completely fine. Pawn up, clearly better position. The game was bishop g5, and now I like very much knight a5, just to force the bishop to go to c2 and to be a bit more passive. And now very important move, f6. Believe me, don't be worried about this move. We are not creating weaknesses, because the pawn on f6 is taking under control the e5 square, and it will be useful for something else. We will see it now. White played bishop f4, knight g6, bishop g3, and Gaia Magami, he decided to play a bit more active with rook c8, rook d1 and bishop c5. But I think that it's completely okay to play here bishop e7, and after h4, castle h5 and knight h8. Many of us will think, wow, this move cannot be good. But it's not bad at all, because this knight is coming to f7. And from f7, is taking under control the center. And this is very, very important. Taking under control e5 square, d6 square. Black is much better in this position. In the game, black played bishop c5, and after h4, castle h5, it was the time for black to give the pawn with knight e5. Knight h8 is possible too, but I like more this active idea, knight e5, and after bishop takes, f takes, knight takes, rook c7, protecting the d7 pawn, and black squares on g5, h4, the f line. White has many weaknesses and the pieces are not really active, so I believe that black is much better here. So this is about bishop c4, but there's one more chance for white to play bishop b2. And here, after analyzing quite a lot the position, I decided that the best way was to play simply bishop b4, castle, and knight g7. The same setup. I don't want to change the thing. the same again. And here, for example, if white plays bishop f4, we play castle, and a3, we simply take on c3, b takes, and d5, and we are pawn up, simply. After queen c2, a bit of the same, but we simply play d5, take, and e takes d5. Again, pawn up, and bishop is coming to f5 at some point. Finally, after a3, we will take on c3, and after b takes c3, castle. And we should not be worried about queen d6, because we will play b6, following bishop b7, rook c8, knight a5 at some point, and we have no weakness at all. So I believe black's position is better. So, this is the video about the Mora Gambit. I'm sure that you will face a lot this gambit. Normally in amateur level, it's played quite a lot, or in the internet. But with this variation, I think you will catch your opponents.